Listening Library presents Your Lonely Nights Are Over by Adam Sass. Read for you by Torian Brackett, Griffin Puatu, and Mark Sanderlin. For Terry and Russell, the Coles in My Life. Author's note, with content warnings. This is the story of Frankie Dearie and Cole Cardoso, two best friends who face down a murderer and, in doing so, end up suspects themselves. However, Dearie is white, and him being a suspect unfolds differently than it does for Cole, who is Latine. So be forewarned, this book occasionally intersects with racism and hostile law enforcement. These characters also grapple with the realities of abusive relationships, like gaslighting and verbal and emotional manipulation, and at times, the abuse becomes physical. These struggles don't dominate the book and are rarely depicted on page, but the story couldn't be told appropriately without them, so just know they are present from time to time. Your Lonely Nights Are Over is an ode to gay friendship. Where I am closest to Dearie, Cole is a combination of my close friends, Terry and Russell, queer men of color who are daily examples of fearlessness, individuality, and impeccable high standards of self-esteem. My mission in life is to be as powerful a friend to them as they've been to me. If you end up loving Cole as much as I do, the credit is theirs. With these advisories in mind, I am very pleased to share with you the adventures of those beautiful, bitchy besties, Dearie and Cole.
The number one streaming show in America is Your Lonely Nights Are Over, The Search for Mr. Sandman. A terrifying docuseries based on the best-selling true crime chiller by Peggy Jennings. Don't frown. Don't pout. Don't ever cry. If he hears your lonely heart, then you're the next to die. From 1971 to 1975, the San Diego serial killer, Mr. Sandman, held the city in his grip, slaying the lovelorn and recently dumped. Any gender, any age, no one was spared. If you were crying over being stood up, if you pined over someone you couldn't be with, if your sweetheart left you for someone new, Mr. Sandman would find out. If he set his sights on you, you were as good as dead. And if you broke someone's heart, you might as well have swung the blade yourself. Why did Mr. Sandman do it? Some say he couldn't stand self-pity. Others believed he wanted people to stop being so careless with one another. Stay together became the rallying cry of a city who believed they could outsmart the most elusive murderer of the 20th century. They thought they could find meaning in the mayhem. In reality, it was a senseless, never-ending bloodbath until one day, without warning, it ended. Almost 50 years later, the killer has not been found or identified. Where did he go? Why did he stop? Is he still alive? And if so, will he strike again? Watch now and see what everyone is talking about.
Part 1, Mr. Sandman. Chapter 1, Dearie. I'm probably the only person in school not obsessed with that Sandman show. I can't escape it. Popular kids, nerds, teachers, janitors. Since the show dropped, everyone's become an amateur detective. Yesterday, AP Bio didn't start for 15 minutes because Mr. Kirby was theorizing about the killer's incomplete shoe print. He and my best friend, Cole Cardoso, went on and on about how modern technology could recreate the print better than 70s computers, if only the evidence still existed.
It's a shame San Diego PD didn't keep better records before the FBI got involved, Mr. Kirby sighed.
Cole was trying to convince Kirby that Mr. Sandman knew someone in the force, a father or friend, who messed with the evidence. But Mr. Kirby just shook his head. Never ascribe to malice what can be explained by incompetence. Cole rolled his eyes.
Corrupt and incompetent, then.
Mr. Kirby clumsily tied his obsession back into the bio lesson for the day, but nobody was mad at the distraction. For the first time in his teaching career, he had his students riveted. Anyway, because Mr. Sandman was never found, this show has my classmates thinking he's behind every corner. But the slayings happened in San Diego, California, and this is Stone Grove, Arizona, a rusty, dusty canyon town of 20,000. A lonely place to live, sure, but unlikely to see the return of a famous boomer slasher. I don't blame people for gossiping. They like thinking something exciting could happen here. But Stone Grove isn't that special. Which is why I'm not bothered about these death threats that have been popping up. They're a prank, as simple as that. Today, Queer Club is meeting about the texting drama during free period, and I'm here to make sure they stop believing the whispers that Cole and I are behind these anonymous texts. This happens a lot. People blaming us. Looking cute and inspiring jealousy are kind of our thing. But death threats? That warrants a public denial. Maybe we should get publicists. High school reputation publicists should be a thing. But until that day comes, I have to make my own statements. So here I am in room 208, the queer club's regularly reserved space, where the band and choir rehearsed before they built the new auditorium. It's a theater-in-the-round classroom with desks scattered across three levels of crescent-shaped stadium platforms. Since the auditorium opened, it's become a flex space, either for clubs or a quiet study area, which is why I'm a stranger here. I study in my own time. Just kidding. I have extremely bad senioritis. Actually, that's also a lie. I got early acceptance to my top choice theater school in LA, so I don't have senioritis. It's more like I'm ready to leave this town so I can start living my life-itis.
I didn't see you at the meeting last week, says a pretty, upbeat white girl with long, silvery hair.
Her name is M. She's a trans sophomore whose cheerleading social circle has never quite bumped into mine, which is a circle of just me and Cole. M and I wait alone in the cavernous classroom, which usually hosts a dozen queer club members, but so far is shockingly empty. Typical. I finally come back to this damn club and everybody ditches. I used to come to these queer meetings when I was a freshman, but I just wasn't a joiner, I admit, brushing on a coat of cherry chapstick. M nods in awkward silence at her desk atop the room's highest platform.
I'm Frankie Dearie, but everyone just calls me Dearie.
M smiles.
I know, you're a big boy senior now.
Her brow furrows.
Boy, right?
Chewing my lower lip, I give my outfit a cursory scan. A black cropped tank with cutouts on the sides, calf-high boots, and a sheer lilac bandana worn tightly around my throat. I snort.
Yeah, boy, but I'm figuring it out.
M sighs into her resting palm.
I feel that.
Tick tock. Where is everyone? Where's Cole? He was supposed to be my buffer. M taps her pen against her cheek, watching me, clearly about to ask what she's wanted to since I sat down.
You know, it's okay if you did it as a prank.
Jesus, I groan. We didn't send those threats.
M throws up innocent palms.
Hey, I thought it was kind of funny.
Believe me, if it was us, we'd claim credit by now. Our primary goal is always attention.
M returns to her phone and I return to mine. No response yet from Cole to my, "Help me, are you close?" texts. I opened a saved screenshot of the reason I'm sitting here in purgatory. The death threat texted from an anonymous number to two members of Queer Club. "Your lonely nights will soon be over." Mr. Sandman used to mail the words in a note to his victim the day before he killed them. If you saw that message, you were as dead as hamburger in 24 hours.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.